Hello, and welcome to Discovery Tapes. The routes have been chosen to show you the most beautiful views and the greatest variety of scenery, as well as covering the majority of the principal places of interest to the visitor. The scenic drive you have chosen starts and finishes in the village of Castleton and is approximately 35 miles long. Each of the discovery drives outlines the beauty of nature to be seen in the Derbyshire landscape. The route takes in green and leafy lanes, quaint and charming villages, and heather-covered moors, to say nothing of the stately homes en route. The time needed to complete this narrated tour is entirely up to you. Stop wherever you wish and visit wherever you want. Have a picnic or take a stroll. Pause the tape when you hear this tone. Also, remember to stop the tape whenever you park or you are held up at a junction. And if you have missed a direction or information, just rewind the tape to that point and continue your journey. As with many country roads, they can be narrow in places, and like the Peak District scenery, always expect the unexpected. The drives are based on an approximate speed of 40 miles an hour on main roads to as little as 50 miles an hour on the narrower sections. Before you start your journey, set the odometer to zero. This will give you an idea where you are on the route. I hope you enjoy your tour, and I look forward to joining you on the other discovery drives in this series. The first drive from Castleton starts from the car park and toilet area, nestling underneath the shadow of Peveril Castle on the hill opposite. Moving forward from the car park, and on reaching the village street, we need to turn right. If you require fuel, we shortly pass the petrol station on our left. Continue climbing, and looking in front, we can see the valley known as Winnats Pass, and shortly we will be travelling up this valley. Turn left by the trees, following the signs for Speedwell Cavern, Blue John Cavern, and the Chestnut Centre. We are now starting the steep ascent of Winnats Pass. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and I will give you further instructions when we have turned left towards Winnats Pass. The first buildings we come to as we climb the hill are that of the Speedwell Cavern, a cave system which is approached by a half-mile boat journey underground, and the car park is on the right opposite the cavern entrance. Remember to switch off now if you visit the cave. Immediately after the cavern, we go over a cattle grid and start the very steep climb. We now have a splendid view as we climb the pass with the high limestone buttresses towering above us. As we exit the pass at the summit, we come to a T-junction, where we need to turn right, following the signs for Chapel on the Frith. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and I will give you further information when we have taken the right turn towards Chapel on the Frith. Immediately having taken this right-hand turn, the hill we see in the foreground is known as Mam Tor. Shortly, the road swings sharply to the left. Continue following the sign for Chapel on the Frith on the main road, with Mam Tor now on our right-hand side. After a while, there is a car park also on our right, where it is possible to pull over, have some refreshment, or take a breathtaking stroll up the steps towards the summit of Mam Tor, where there are spectacular views over the Hope and Edale valleys. Pause the tape when you hear the tone if you wish to park. If not, continue listening. Immediately after the car park, we need to turn right, following the signs for Barber Booth and Edale. Having turned right, we now climb the hill towards a viewpoint known as Mam Nick, overlooking the Edale Vale. In the distance, as we drive between the rocks on either side of the road, we have a splendid view of Kinderscout Moor on the horizon. Our journey descends now, twisting and turning down the steep incline. Listen to the music whilst enjoying the spectacular views as we descend towards the valley floor. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and rejoin it when you see the sign for Edale on the right-hand side of the road, just before the bridge. Ignore the turn to Upper Booth on our left, and continue forward towards the village itself, approximately 1 mile further along the valley road. Do not take the left-hand turn into the village itself, as the village is a cul-de-sac, and there is parking for residents only. Just past the turn into the village, there is a car park. Drive into the car park. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and I will give you further instructions when you have parked your car. You may wish to take a short walk into the village, leaving the car park and walking underneath the bridge towards the National Park Information Centre ahead. You may also like to take refreshments at one of the village's two inns. Edale has a number of pretty cottages and an attractive church. Further along, past the church, we come to the famous Old Nag's Head, which is synonymous with the fame of Edale, as being the start of the Pennine Way, a walk which is some 270 miles in length and finishes at a village known as Kirkyetam, just over the Scottish border. Edale has been a centre for walking for many years, as the Kinderscout Plateau towers above at just over 2,000 feet above sea level. The weather can be very changeable around here, and walking is only advised for those with proper experience and equipment. If you do take a walk into the village and visit any of the attractions I have mentioned, including the National Park Visitor Centre, on your return to the car, I will give you further details of our route ahead down this wonderful valley. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and I will give you further instructions when you are ready to resume our journey. As we leave the car park, we turn left and continue driving down this picturesque valley. After a while, we approach a number of houses. Continue along and under the railway bridge number 49, and on to the small hamlet of Nether Booth, which is a small collection of farms, farm buildings and trekking centre. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, as I will now let you travel down the valley, unaccompanied for a while, until you reach the railway bridge number 48, where we will rejoin the tape. A little further on from the railway bridge, we travel over a bridge which spans the River Noe. Thank you. As we approach the village of Hope, passing the Cheshire Cheese Inn, and on towards the T-junction opposite the village church, where our journey will turn left in the direction of Sheffield on the A625. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and rejoin it when we have made the left-hand turn opposite the church onto the A625 to Sheffield. Having left the village of Hope behind, and after approximately 1 mile, we need to turn right at the junction opposite the Traveller's Rest Inn in the direction of Bradwell and Tideswell, on the B6049. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and rejoin the tape when we have made the right-hand turn towards Bradwell and Tideswell. We are now on Brough Lane Head, where we travel over the bridge past the mill on our right, which is now an agricultural merchant's, and continue forward into the village of Bradwell, where we proceed along the main road straight through the village. Bradwell was born out of the lead mining industry, and its small cottages cling to the hillside in the older part of the village. But now, a larger part of the population have found employment in the local engineering works and also the cement works. Bradwell is also famous for the delicious Bradwell's ice cream, which is produced here in its many varieties of flavours. Pause the tape at the tone and rejoin our journey as we leave the village of Bradwell behind. Thank you. As we climb out of the valley from Bradwell on the main road towards Tideswell, after approximately 1.5 miles, we come to a crossroads by a small barn on our left, indicating the road towards the village of Little Hucklow on our right. Ignore this crossroads and continue forwards. Pause the tape when you hear the tone and resume our journey as we pass the turning towards Little Hucklow. Continue ascending towards the small hamlet on the horizon, the area known as Windmill. Near the brow of the hill, where the road sweeps right, we need to turn left for Great Hucklow and the Gliding Club. Almost immediately, we come to a give-way sign at the crossroads, where we need to turn left again. We are now travelling towards the village called Great Hucklow. Pause the tape when you hear the tone and resume our journey as we pass the Queen Anne Inn on our right as we enter the village. Travel through the village and pass the red telephone box on our right, following the signs for the Gliding Club straight ahead. As we leave the village, we come to a junction on our right, signposted towards the village of Grindleford. But our journey continues straight ahead, rising towards the Gliding Club and Bretton, 1.5 miles. Continue rising on this road and into the woods. Ignore the sign on our left pointing us in the direction of the Gliding Club and Abney, but continue along and onto this splendid ridge road with fine views on either side. We are now travelling towards the highest public house in Derbyshire, known as the Barrel Inn at Bretton. At the next junction, we give way and need to turn left, still rising towards the Barrel Inn, which stands at 1,200 feet above sea level. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and if you wish to park at the inn and take in the view, or perhaps have a short stroll, return to the tape when you are ready to continue our journey. Our journey continues towards the summit, and along this spectacular road, towards the Sir William Hill television mast. Ignore the rough road marked unsuitable for motors, which leads to the mast as our journey swings to the right. When we reach the track to the mast on the right-hand bend, the large grass verges make an ideal place to pull over and take a stroll along the old track towards the mast and its trig point and panoramic views. Switch off when you hear the tone if you wish to park or take a stroll. To continue, we proceed along the road where we have views down on our right, overlooking the village of Eam, before we travel through the small hamlet of Highcliff. After approximately half a mile from the hamlet of Highcliff, we come to a T-junction, where we need to take the left-hand road signposted towards Grindleford, 2 miles. Pause the tape when you hear the tone and rejoin it when we have made the left-hand turn towards Grindleford. Having turned left, and after a while, we start our descent down Sir William Hill into the village of Grindleford. Thank you. At the T-junction at the bottom of this long descent, and opposite the Sir William Hotel, we need to turn right. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and we will continue when we have turned right at the hotel. Having turned right, we go past Grindleford Primary School. Caution must be taken here, as immediately round the corner is another T-junction, where we need to turn left in the direction of Sheffield on the B6521, towards the traffic lights on the bridge. Pause the tape when you hear the tone and resume our journey when we reach the bridge. We now move forward, ascending out of the valley and past the splendid Maynard Arms Hotel on our right-hand side. After approximately 2 miles, on our right-hand side, we will see the beautiful Longshaw Estate House, nestling under the hill in the trees. We will be visiting the house shortly. Continue on to the next T-junction, where we need to turn right towards Sheffield on the A625, following the signs for Longshaw Estate. Pause the tape at the tone and resume immediately after having turned right at the next junction, following the signs for Longshaw Estate. Almost immediately, take the road towards the right by the Fox House Hotel in the direction of Dronfield and Chesterfield. Having turned, and approximately a quarter of a mile further on, we come to an entrance on our right into the car park and over the cattle grid towards the Longshaw Estate. Turn into the car park. Pause when you hear the tone, and when you have parked, I will give you further information. Unfortunately, the house is not open to the public, as this is now private apartments, but the Longshaw Estate, which includes over 1,500 acres of moors, woods and farmland, is owned and managed by the National Trust. There are a number of beautiful footpaths within the estate. Longshaw Estate is open at all times throughout the year. Longshaw Visitor Centre, which includes cafe, shop and information centre, can be reached from this point via the footpath at the foot of the car park. The Visitor Centre is open at weekends throughout the year, including Bank Holiday Mondays from 10:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. or sunset if earlier. It is also open Wednesdays, Thursdays and Fridays from the end of March until Christmas. Pause the tape again, and when you are ready to leave Longshaw Estate, we will continue our journey. When we leave the car park, we return over the cattle grid and retrace our route for a short while towards the Fox House Hotel and bear left again by the Fox House Hotel towards Castleton and Hathersage on the A625. Pause at the tone and we will continue our journey when we reach the junction opposite the hotel. Travel forward and pass the turn to Grindleford. Shortly we can see in front of us a flat-topped hill. This hill is known as Carl Wark, where the remains of an old Roman fort have been found. Shortly, we arrive back into Derbyshire, as the sign indicates on our left. Approximately half a mile further on, we come to Surprise View Car Park on our right-hand side. There are some spectacular walks from this car park, along the gritstone edges, and towards the hill known as Carl Wark and Higger Tor. There are way-marked paths towards the rear of the car park. Pause the tape at the tone if you wish to park. If you have parked, to resume our journey, we will need to turn right, continuing in the direction of Castleton. As we travel along this road, we come to a sharp right-hand bend, known as Surprise View Corner. Its name will become self-evident as we emerge past the rocks on either side of the road. We now start our gentle descent into the village of Hathersage. In Hathersage churchyard is the grave, reputed to be that of Little John, of Robin Hood fame. It is a beautiful church, sitting in its elevated position overlooking the village. Do explore this delightful village. If you wish to park, follow the signs towards the main village car park by turning left by the George Hotel. Pause the tape at the tone and we will continue as we reach the George Hotel in the centre of the village. To continue our journey, we need to drive past the George Hotel in the direction of Chapel-on-the-Frith and underneath the railway bridge, where we start travelling along the Hope Valley Road back in the direction of Castleton. Continue along the valley road past the Marquis of Granby Hotel, approximately 1 mile further on our left-hand side. Pause the tape at the tone until we reach the Marquis of Granby Hotel. Shortly, we come to an S-bend, and almost immediately afterwards, we have the High Peak Garden Centre, which is well worth a visit. Pause the tape at the tone, and I will leave you to drive down the valley, returning to the tape as we reach Hope Church and the Woodruff Arms Hotel. As we travel towards Castleton, we will see the dominating feature of the Blue Circle Cement Works, which has been on this site since 1928. Although looking incongruous in these beautiful surroundings, it brings and has brought generations of employment for the local inhabitants. The company has a continuing program of landscaping and environmental awareness in this scenic and sensitive landscape. Thank you. continue straight ahead towards the village of Castleton, from where we started our journey. I hope you have enjoyed your drive, and I look forward to joining you on our second drive from Castleton. The second drive from Castleton is approximately 35 miles in length. Please set your odometer to zero again, as this will give you an indication of where you are on the route. Remember to pause the tape as soon as you hear the tone. The second drive from Castleton starts from the same car park as the first tour we made. Moving forward from the car park, we come to the main village street. This time, we turn left and drive down the village street into Castleton, past the Bull's Head and the Castle Hotel. We shortly come to a sharp left-hand bend, and then almost immediately a right-hand bend. And then we continue through the village, past the Peak Hotel. Pause the tape when you hear the tone and rejoin our journey as we leave the village behind. We are now travelling along the main valley road in the direction of the next village, which is called Hope. We will see the Blue Circle cement works with its tower and chimney on our right-hand side. Continue moving forwards for approximately 3/4 of a mile and over the mini roundabout after the railway bridge and on towards the Woodruff Hotel and church on our right-hand side. Pause the tape when you hear the tone and continue our journey when we reach the church in Hope. After approximately 1 mile, having left the village of Hope behind us, we come to a junction. We turned right here on our first journey, but this time we continue straight ahead, passing the Traveller's Rest Hotel on our left. We are now travelling in the direction of Sheffield. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and we will continue our journey down the valley when we pass the Marquis of Granby Hotel on our right-hand side, approximately 2 miles further down the valley road. Our journey still continues forward in the direction of Sheffield and towards the village of Hathersage. Pause the tape at the tone and switch on again as we go under the railway bridge just as we enter the village of Hathersage. Continue along the main street, ascending out of the village, still in the direction of Sheffield. Remember to switch the tape off now if you wish to park and explore the village. Refuel or visit the large outdoor shop. Continue rising up the hill on the main road to Sheffield. Pause the tape at the tone and return to our journey when we pass the Millstone Hotel on our left as we ascend out of the village. Immediately after the Millstone Hotel, we see a road sign indicating a junction coming in on our left. We need to take this left-hand road, signposted Ringinglow by the toll bar cottage. Listen to the music as we continue rising onto the moors beyond the toll bar cottage, and shortly I will give you further information of our journey ahead. Thank you. Soon, we will cross a cattle grid, and immediately after, we need to turn sharp left and almost double back on ourselves. Having taken this left turn, we come to a hard standing grass verge on our left-hand side, where it is possible to park. We now have a complete panoramic view over the entire Hope Valley. On our right, you may be able to pick out the Trig Point at 1,500 feet above sea level on the gritstone edge. Pull over onto the grass verge and rest a while. If you wish to take a walk towards the Trig Point on the gritstone edge, there is a well-defined footpath a little further on. Or you may wish to just sit and take in this beautiful view. Pause the tape again at the tone and return to the tape when you are ready to continue our journey, and I will give you further information. Moving forwards, we begin to descend from the summit, with the small picturesque farmhouse below on our left-hand side. Just past the farmhouse, we will see a road on our right-hand side. We need to take this turn, signposted in the direction of Ladybower. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and when you have taken this right-hand turn towards Ladybower, signposted 5 miles, we will continue. Now, having turned right, we continue descending, but looking over to our right, we can see the towering buttresses of the gritstone edge, known as Stanage Edge. You may well be able to pick out one or two climbers on most days of the week, as these gritstone edges are famous with the climbing clubs of Great Britain, where many a budding young climber has gained their experience. And some went on to become quite famous, such as Joe Brown and Chris Bonington. Do feel free to pull over where it is possible and have a look or take a stroll towards these gritstone edges. But there is a much larger national park car park coming up shortly. If you do pull over here, remember to switch the tape off until you are ready to continue, and I will give you further instructions. Proceeding forward, the road continues, descending towards the wood. But we need to turn right, just prior to the trees, continuing in the direction of Ladybower, 4 miles. Shortly, we come to the large car park I mentioned earlier on our right-hand side. This is known as Hollin Bank and is a national park car park. Pull into the car park if you wish, and take a stroll from the rear of the car park. If you intend to visit the car park, pause the tape now. If you wish to continue, or when you leave the car park, turn right and proceed forward for a short while, listening to the music until I give you further instructions. After a while, we come to a sign indicating that we are about to cross a cattle grid. Once we are over the cattle grid, we need to turn sharp left and over another. Shortly past the second cattle grid, we need to turn right, continuing in the direction of Ladybower, rising for a short while before we descend along the narrow road which clings to the side of the hill. Pause the tape at the tone until you have made this next right-hand turn. After our initial ascent, we travel along this narrow road for a while before our descent becomes steeper. At this point, we can look across the valley towards the dark-topped hill known as Wynn Hill. This hill is reproduced as a photograph in the accompanying booklet. Continue downhill towards the valley floor. Thank you. pause the tape again at the tone and continue our descent towards the T-junction with the main Bamford to Sheffield road opposite the telephone box. We need to turn right in the direction of Ladybower and Sheffield. Having turned, we immediately go past the houses on our left, which were built to rehouse the residents of the villages of Derwent and Ashupton. The villages were flooded when the dams were built. The reservoir we are now travelling past is known as Ladybower. Soon, there is a National Park car park on our right, known as Heatherdene. This is an ideal place to park, rather than use the roadside verges, which can be quite dangerous and crowded in the summer. Pause the tape now if you wish to park. Further ahead, we travel over the Ladybower Viaduct, at the end of which we come to a T-junction with the main A57 Glossop to Sheffield Road, known as the Snake Pass. We need to turn left in the direction of Glossop. Having made this left turn, we continue along and shortly we travel over the Ashupton Viaduct. Immediately towards the end of this viaduct, we need to turn right, following the signs for the Derwent Valley. Pause the tape at the tone and rejoin the tape when we have made this right-hand turn into the Derwent Valley. We now travel over a cattle grid. This picturesque valley is one of the more popular areas for visitors to the national park, and as such, this road can become very sensitive to traffic during high season. Please adhere to all the car parking notices and do not park on the grass verge. Continue forward, utilising the adequate parking facilities that have been provided. Further along the road, we come to a traffic island at Fairholmes Car Park, which has a cafe for light refreshments, a visitors' centre and cycle hire centre. The journey ahead from the roundabout as we turn into Fairholmes Car Park has restricted access on Sundays and bank holidays. Please read the notices provided for information about access on the day of your visit. Thank you. When you find somewhere to park, be it at Fairholmes or one of the other smaller parking areas provided, I will give you further information regarding the Derwent Valley. For the more able of us, I suggest you hire one of the many bikes available, as this is a level road ahead, and it is the most peaceful way to explore the rest of the Derwent Valley. Pause the tape at the tone, and return when you have found somewhere to park. A little further down the valley, just behind the wrought iron gates of the Derwent Dam Tower, there is a memorial stone which reads, "This stone was erected by public subscription to the gallant men of 617 Dambusters Squadron RAF, who successfully breached the dams of Western Germany in World War II using the bouncing bomb devised by Dr. Barnes Wallace." Derwent Dam was chosen because of its close resemblance to the German dams for intensive low-level practice and bomb-aiming techniques. If access is available further along from Fairholmes car park on the day of your visit, continue listening, and I will tell you a little of what lies ahead down the valley before I let you travel unaccompanied from our present position. Continue along the road and past the famous Derwent Dam Wall, which is synonymous with the aforementioned practicing of the bouncing bomb and the Dambuster raid during World War II. Proceed with care and caution along this narrow road for the next 4.5 miles. We will shortly be returning to Fairholmes car park, as there is no exit at the far end of the valley. Keep a lookout. On our right-hand side, after approximately 2 miles, we will see, at the side of the road in the trees, a small gritstone marker, which you will see reproduced in the accompanying booklet, which indicates the boundary of the village of Birchinlee, which was a temporary village set up for the dam and reservoir builders. After a while, we will cross over a small, narrow bridge, and then we will be travelling on the far side of the reservoir in the opposite direction. When we reach the traffic island at the head of the valley, we see the royal oak tree, known as the King's Tree, which was planted by His Majesty King George VI on the 25th of September 1945 to commemorate the opening of the reservoirs. This is as far as the road goes. Turn round at the island, and we will continue our journey, returning back towards Fairholmes car park. Pause the tape when you hear the tone, and we will continue our journey when you return to Fairholmes car park, having explored the valley further on. After the roundabout at Fairholmes car park, or where you have parked, continue back towards the main A57, Glossop to Sheffield Road. At the junction ahead, our journey turns left, returning across the viaduct. Pause the tape at the tone, and when we have taken the left turn, and as we cross over the viaduct, return to the tape for further instructions. After we have crossed over the Ashupton Viaduct, we shortly come to the junction again with the Ladybower Viaduct. We need to turn right for Bamford on the A6103. Pause the tape at the tone, and when we have turned right across the viaduct towards Bamford, switch on again for further instructions. I hope you enjoyed your journey down the Derwent Valley. And now, continuing ahead, we are travelling towards the village of Bamford. When we have travelled through Bamford, we reach the main junction opposite the Marquis of Granby Hotel. We need to turn right, again following the main road down the valley in the direction of Hope and Castleton. Pause the tape at the tone and rejoin the tape when you have turned right towards Castleton as we reach the junction opposite the Marquis of Granby Hotel. Whilst we travel along this road, I will tell you some information and history of the village of Castleton. The ruins standing above the small village of Castleton are that of Peveril Castle. Peveril Castle was granted to William Peveril by William I in 1086, but most of the present castle was built after the Peverils and dates from around 1176 during the reign of King Henry II. Norman castles are not very common in Derbyshire, and Peveril Castle is the only one with substantial remains left above the ground, and has not been inhabited since the 15th century. Castleton has some of the most fantastic caverns in the country, which can be visited by the public. Not least of all, the history and site of Peak Cavern, which has one of the largest entrances in the world. So large, in fact, that once there were houses and even a public house inside the roof at the mouth of the entrance. If you visit the cavern, you will be able to see the roof blacken from the chimneys which burnt within, and even up till early this century, there was a thriving rope-making industry within the mouth of the cavern. Castleton is also famous for the semi-precious stone known as Blue John, which is extremely rare and can only be found in certain parts of the world. The stone is fashioned into many forms of jewellery, which you will be able to find in the local jewellery shops along the main village street. You will also be able to see the stone in its natural form within the cave known as Blue John and Treat Cliff Caverns. The largest single piece made from Blue John is a vase which can be found at Chatsworth House. Other facts regarding Castleton and its surrounding area can be found in the information centre in the centre of the village. I hope you have enjoyed your two circular drives from Castleton, and I look forward to joining you on other tours within the Peak District and further afield.